Just a reminder, today's conference is being recorded.
So, hello everybody to this month's Accept Cafe. And we are not very many people. Last time it was really packed with the Abbott showcase being showed. So that was obviously a something which was very interesting. And today we don't have any real specific topic. I had two comments up front from people outside. So one was from Ivan, and one was from another colleague or ex-colleague from SAP, but he's not yet joined, so maybe we'll skip that. We can, or I can present something about that anyway. So the other topic was about QM integration with BI Sheet. I can tell you something about that a little bit. And the other question, maybe we can do that first, was Ivan's question concerning the differences between the old-fashioned generation and the filter there and the new generation scope with XSTEPS.
And basically how to do it in the best way, because the combinations of it. So I've read the document that you made, and then okay, I get some insights on how to do it, but do I then have to create one for every case, or can I combine them, so to speak?
Okay. Yeah, I've presented a small example there where I put some flexibility in the body for the XSTEPS, and I believe I've shown this a couple of times before, but I can do it once again. It's not a problem. So let's jump into the repository. Oh, I have to switch. So did everybody fill out the forms here? Then we'll just switch over to the presentation mode. So that'll be here. And I'll share the screen. Oops. Something. Okay. Do you see my screen?
Not yet.
Okay. We've had a new version of this here. This is really weird here. Okay. So do you see my screen now?
No, it's still the questionnaire.
Still the questionnaire. That's really odd, because that's really. Oh boy, what's happening here?
Well, it's the next step cafe, so we can get something to drink, yeah?
By the way, I've got an iced coffee here, because it's very hot here in Germany. But this is really odd. Switch something with my screen setting here. Sorry about that. I have to kill that session here. So maybe you have to log on again. It's really not working at all here. Sorry about that. Do it again. Were you dropped off from the session now, or are you still in?
We are still in.
Okay, let's see how this... Maybe I have to restart the recording later. Something is really odd here. I don't know what happens. Okay, let's try this again. Share my screen, desktop. Do you see something now?
No, it's still the questionnaire.
Still the questionnaire?
At least for me.
Oh boy, I've got some... Ah. Okay, now I know what happened. I was still in preparing mode, sorry for that. What about now?
Yeah, much better now.
Great.
Much better.
Okay. So, you see the Extev repository now?
Yep.
Yeah.
Great. Okay, let's keep the recording going, though. Still recording. Yes. Okay. Okay. So here in the in my weighing scenario, I have these generation scopes used, and actually, what I was using is a custom generation scope like these. So it's one of these body implementations I used there.
Yes.
And what I did, and I will show that in the class just in a second, is I have also here a parameter which is called FLT sortf, which is the filter for the sort string, and I'm evaluating it here with this string here.
Yes.
What I also do is, of course, I've got another parameter which actually evaluates the sort string itself. So you have to distinguish between the sort string, which is evaluated automatically here, and the filter, which I use here. Okay. So now what I'm doing is in the body implementation here, and that's actually, I think that's one of the examples which are in the document on the SDN. And here in the first section, this one here, I am looping over all the parameters of the XDEP. Yes, so there are some methods. Okay, you have to know that they are there, but somebody told me that these are there. So I can loop over all the parameters of the actual XDEP and get the values of every of these parameters. So you could extend this to other filter or switching parameters.
Bitte warten Sie.
Oh boy, what is this?
Please hold the line.
Okay. So, I had to mute the colleague here. So I got the value of this filter here, and I'm imprinting it here into this value here. So L_sort. If I don't find this parameter, I evaluate this L_sort with this the asterisk, which means I will later on take every sort string or every entry. Yes, and
You basically, just if you look at it once again, you
you take this parameter FLT sort F, and then you compare it with the value that you got from the value you got from the X step.
Exactly. So what I'm doing here is I'm reusing an existing generation scope, which is this one here, just the reservation items here, and then I'm going over this table here, and then where is it?
There you have it, so with the L, with the source string in the middle there, a little bit up.
Ah, yeah. Thank you. So that's it, yeah? So if this source string here is not in the pattern of this string here, then it is deleted. So it goes the other way around. So it deletes all things that are not in this pattern here. And then you've got your filter applied. Yeah. So
then you got the filter applied on the sort string, and then you do in the second part here. You see if this is
a split
key.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the possibilities here are endless. I mean, it's just about ABAP or ABAP object you need to do
I
the
see,
end here.
Yeah.
So.
But here you're combining it, and that's
exactly. Yeah. And. And compared with the old filter and the old generation, it's of course you need to do some programming here. Okay, that's the bad information here, but the good information here is that you are much more flexible. You can really adjust it to your needs. So you could either decide to create several generation scopes, just each one for a specific need, or you can try to create more generic generation scope, like I did it here, with one that is focusing on material or reservation items. No? So that is the idea behind that.
Yeah. So basically, this one is taking into account if it's batch determined or there's positions with no batches. Okay, then you're also deleting it.
Yeah.
But then you need to do you need to repeat this code in another session if you want to have, say, just those as a not batch controlled materials, but according to a certain source string.
Well, that entirely depends on the logic you apply here. This has to be really looked into in much more detail then, of course. This is pure programming then.
Yeah, sure.
You just need to define or first check what different combinations of of filtering you need, and then you have to design a logic that can do this maybe in one generation scope with some case structures here and some maybe pre-filtering, which I did here. So first I filter out all things that are not in the source string definition, and then I do some other things.
Yeah, and the case FLT value.
Yes, that's the generation scope actually. So this filter dash generation is actually what you. And that's now I'm switching over to
customizing.
To the customizing, which is CMX05, where you can see all these things. So here you see. And at the bottom, all these custom-made generation scopes, and here these are the names, yeah. So that batch determined, that batch not determined, and these are these names.
Yes.
That no batch is another one. I think that's this one here, and that sort I don't have in the case structure, but it's using this anyway. So this is the most generic use of this generation scope.
Yeah.
Mm.
So you have them actually inside all of the other ones as
yes,
well.
Yes, that's what I have decided, but you can also do it differently.
And definitely it makes sense is what I'm seeing here.
Mm.
Yeah.
You should have this coding in this document, do you?
I don't think it's inside a document, so that detailed. So this.
I thought I had included it.
Only the sort string part was there, but I'm not sure now.
All right, so I'll check it, and if you're interested, I can also send you this coding. It's no problem.
That would be great.
Yes, sure. This is not a big secret here.
Well, it's actually so long on the screen now that
you could grab screenshots, of course, then later on and type it. Okay. Any other questions, comments on this or? No?
And now it was only I'm looking into the document straight away now. Oh, it was only that part, as far as I could see.
Let's check whether this colleague is.
It's only that part.
Okay. So Andreas, are you still with us?
Yeah.
You had some weird music suddenly, so I had to mute you.
No, it's not me.
It was you. There was music, and then I muted you, and then the music was gone. So it just in case you had said something, you need to repeat it.
Okay, good to know. I didn't hear any music. But
yeah,
it's okay. Good.
Okay. Weird. Okay. So any other comments on this? Questions? Okay. Then. Yeah, there was this question on how to include QM in this whole PI sheet concept, and there is of course just explain this in words. There's of course this possibility to have a function call which just jumps to that result recording of QM with pre-filled inspection lot, for example. That's something you can do. Which is of course a very loose integration. And there is another thing which I can show you in with the classical process instructions only, because, and I will explain later why I'll do that only there. Which is let's look at this order. So this order uses the normal process instructions, and I've got in this destination here, I've got a generated instruction, which is generated for each inspection characteristic, and maybe I'm also switching to the recipe there. There you have this button here where you can maintain all these in-process control inspection characteristics. I'm very familiar with this because I didn't use it a lot in my time here as a consultant, but that's where it's maintained with some values, upper and lower limit target values. And then there's some possibilities to do some generation here, but it's very limited also in this process instruction category. So if I go in here, you see that you have the inspection lot here automatically evaluated, order phase, that's normal. You've got the inspection characteristic, which is, I'm switching over to here, which is this line number here. And then that's it. And then you can choose to evaluate these four characteristics. So number of inspections, short text, the result, and some deviation statistics. And in the PI sheet, it looks like this. Yeah, I've decide to use your repeated instructions, and that's the bad thing. You don't have any characteristic that shows you some meaningful text. Like for example here, it says sieve size, water content, or something like that. I checked it, and there's nothing. And you only have this characteristic number, and then you can enter number of inspections, some full text like number one maybe. The result is two deviation. I don't know, like this, and then maybe this one here, number two, which is outside of spec. So let's just give you this as an example here, or maybe also here. Table line, and then there's a process message there. Does anybody of you already know this?
So I know it, and basically in those projects we haven't used it for a couple of reasons, because when you send now the process message, you will also need to go into QM and say that
exactly. That's what
result.
I wanted to, was about
and,
to.
And the other thing is also when you work with physical samples or inspection points, you also get into problems. So you could always, with the regular function module, you could have using, say, additional the user exits for evaluating. You could have gotten the sieve size and water content and the names and so on into the PI sheet. But
Concerning that process message, I had one customer where they created an own message destination that actually wrote the values directly into the results. So it was not like I show it now, but it was really written directly into it. Yeah. But the thing is, you don't have the limits here, so you don't have like this, not the chance in the PI sheet to really check beforehand whether this is inside the limits or not. So if you just plainly put it in the results, you don't see anything. And I think that's the reason why this is done like that, so that you have to check it here in this transaction. And you see here, you see the log, the message here that there are process message exists for that. And I see I'm clicking here, and there's no value help because I didn't send any process messages here, right? So, and you see here, these are the ones I just entered in the PI sheet. I can choose one, press enter, and that's outside spec, so it's red here, and here I have only one, and then, I can only choose that one, and then I have the possibility here to see checks and make comments or something like that. And the thing is, and that's the difference here in XTAPS, is that there is no standard generation for that. So that's maybe a gap, but I don't know how many customers really use that concept. So if you want to use that, you need to create an OSS message one day to say, hey, this function worked with the old transposons instructions. Yeah, we want to have it also with the XTAPS. But of course, you can also create your own generation scope by yourself, and then really check in all the tables. Of course, you have to know all the tables where to find the information, and then you of course can also extend it compared to the old version, and also have the spec range here, and of course also that the text of it also evaluated as a symbol, and then it is maybe a much nicer functionality as the one I just showed. So just maybe as a final remark here, these are the these are the process messages. It's not just for you to show, so it looks like this.
And what I said is that normally when you have the jump over, you can have a jump into the physical sample drawing, and you have a jump into the inspection not, or the results recording. And most cases, they have been quite happy to, say, be guided into the different different transactions like that. So.
Yeah, I mean, depends a little bit on how much you can expect from the operators on the line. So if,
yeah.
if they jump to a very complicated QM transaction, maybe that's too much. and then maybe the PI sheet approach would be much simpler. But again, there are some obstacles here to overcome. There's another intermediate solution that one customer of mine created, which was also with a jump, but with a parameterized jump that has also a guided the user to a certain operation of the inspection plan. And they did some, I don't know, an either modification or user exit stuff, which prevented then the user to jump to any other operation there. So they had really in each phase one or two or multiple jumps to certain areas of the inspection plan, then they could only enter there the results, and then they had to go back, and then they were back in the PI sheet again. So this was also a very nice implementation, and the reason why they wanted to do that was they didn't want to put it in the PI sheet, because whenever you have to change anything there in the PI sheet, you have to do all the stuff with the authorities. Yeah? So you need to get the approval from the authorities for these new batch records, and if it's just a jump which is never changed, you don't have to do that, and then you can do these checks in the QM, and you're fine with your batch record. I don't know how you see that it's in your companies. Okay.
I think that the standard function module that you have for jumping, that goes actually to the transaction for that operation.
Yes, there's one process instruction, one of the old types, which has an implicit jump only. So there's no real function call there in the instruction, but the system knows it's because it's of instruction type, I don't know, 5 or so, that it has to jump to the proper inspection lot. And the other...
I think it is mentioned in the documentation
You
have...
it is. I can show
function module, so on and so on.
Mm-hmm. It's looks like this. Find one. Yeah, here. So it's of type 5, and you see type 5 means inspection results request, and actually there's no explicit function module call here. Yes.
Yeah.
Which is, of course, and this is not available with XSTEPS. So there's nothing like this in XSTEPS, so you have to use the normal function module call to that transaction, and there's this possibility to give parameters to that transaction call as well to guide the user to a specific sheet. So jumping over the some selection screen.
Yes, I think so.
Hmm?
Yeah.
Well, it takes over the inspection lot number automatically.
Yes, that one you have to, of course, to evaluate beforehand to give it to that transaction.
Yeah, otherwise you will find the empty transaction.
Yes, and if you want to jump into a specific operation, for example, then you also need that as a fixed information. So that was all I had from the comments that were sent to me up front. So up to you if you want to discuss something else. Anything? Well,
always a lot to discuss,
we can,
isn't it?
Pardon?
Always a lot to discuss.
yeah. While we're thinking, please take your time to rate the session as well. It's on the bottom left corner. And I don't have any problem also to make this a short session if you want. If nobody else has any question or want to discuss anything, I'm fine with that. Maybe, Andreas, could you explain a little bit what kind of functionalities in PI sheets you're using at Merck?
So far, mainly we use two or three different PI sheets. The we use the new browser-based PI sheets as well as the old ones, the ABAP list-based.
Okay.
The new ones are mainly used for the posting of goods issue confirmations and goods issue and goods receipt to process orders. We have another PI sheet in place where we print some information coming from the process orders plus some sort of barcode, which is later on read in one of our warehouses to post additional things.
Mm-hmm.
And a third one is also related to one of our warehouses, production warehouses.
Okay.
And the advantage is really to have several functionalities where people can work on the process order at the same time. Otherwise, if you would use the normal transactions like the MIGO or whatever, you would get locked if another person is working on that.
It's an asynchronous process.
And things like that, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you're not using it as a batch record tool?
No. This is, we disable this functionality in all the process messages, and we just do the current posting, so there's no batch record.
How many users are using PR sheets?
Good question. These are several production plants, as I said, mainly in the Gansheim side, where we have really 24/7 shifts, and I don't know.
50? No. 100?
Probably 200 or...
Okay.
200, 300, something like that.
Okay. And it's always good to know how many, because we only see ERP licenses and not users for PI sheets or something. So
yeah.
I don't know which how many people are really
I'm not
using.
Quite sure about the really current number, but yeah, so as I said, they are working really in shifts 24/7, so...
You can send me a mail. I'm always curious about that.
That's okay.
Okay. I've seen Doug has logged in. Is he already on the phone? Doug, are you here?
No.
It's pretty late. Anything else? Maybe Ivan. How many users are using the PI sheet at your sites?
Well, I'm a consultant then, so it depends then. But I could, and that's perhaps a question to disclose, but we made for one pharmaceutical company, we made a PI sheet for packaging, a full PI sheet with all the different steps from, say, determination, also we implemented a cleaning matrix, entering what was the predecessor and what was the coming product and the determining what the cleaning requirements were. We were also logging who was working on this order and to a full material reconciliation on batches and so on. So that's going, that was in Denmark, pharmaceutical company, and that is going then very successfully for, I think it's like now 3 years now, in production on all their packaging lines. I would expect, I'm not sure how many users, but I would think something like 50 or something like that. And then we are working with another site in Norway from the same company where we are going to implement PI sheets based on X steps for granulation first, and then we are going probably to all the other manufacturing areas as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I had another question then.
Yes.
We had with this, or we still have an OSS message. with, and SAP has also said that they agree that it is a cumbersome thing. But I was wondering if you have had that issue at all, and it comes if you have an automatic close of the table line in a repeated data request, and you're generating a message when using X steps, and this is now on 5.0, the ECC 5.0, SAP says that all parameters which are mandatory in the process message needs either to be input parameters in the X step or in the process instruction, or it needs to be output. So it cannot be that, for instance, process order is evaluated in background and you don't see it.
No. I don't think so. I mean, that's. But
because
it shouldn't be, because that's really not. I mean, with process instructions, this was also not needed. So
yes.
You can always say, okay, this is how it also worked in the past, and this is how it should work.
And SAP say that it is.
I don't.
Working on it.
I cannot rule out that for some reasons the functionality has changed there. It might be a bug. Yes, but so you have to insist maybe.
They have said that they're coming back with a solution to it. So
okay.
I was wondering if this was something which was solved in future releases, since we are still on 5.0.
Yeah, you have to rely here on OSS, and I really don't want to discuss a lot here, which is more belongs to OSS.
Okay, I agree.
Arno, probably I have a question for you.
Yes.
As mentioned, we use the triages to post goods issue to our process orders. And for these cases where we have unplanned consumption of a certain material, we have a table where we have the possibility to insert repeated unplanned consumption. And unfortunately, due to this table and this line, we couldn't really close the PI sheets afterwards in a proper way, so it remains open. The only possibility really I have is to enter a material even with a zero quality.
No, you shouldn't do that, no.
Yeah.
The solution for that is, which release are you on?
That's the, 4.6, I believe.
Oh, boy, okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you don't have any release updates planned, by chance? Because why I say this is the proper way to address this is since 4.7 there is the possibility to use commands and events, and doing so you can deactivate such a process instruction initially. And then you have an activated process instruction which has a switch. So it's just a trigger, an entry field which says yes or no or something like that. And based on that value, you activate or maybe also deactivate again this instruction. Yes?
Okay.
So I don't have any other easy answer for that. We will not discuss anything which you can do in 4.6c because that's, I don't know how long it's in maintenance still, but this is really our oldest release. And
No, I know, but just something where we are struggling till today.
Yeah, that's too bad. I mean, what...
That's actually also the solution that we made then for the other pharmaceutical, that we have a do you need extra material, yes or no, and then you open another section.
Yes, exactly. So that should be a good reason for you to upgrade.
I will recommend this to the management.
Yes. And by the way, you mentioned that you were also sending things to the warehouse there, and that's also an interesting thing. I've got one customer who is actually using the PI sheets in the warehouse in the Staplerfahrer,
the forklift truck,
forklift vehicles. So they have a laptop there on the forklifter, and there the PI sheet is running.
Yeah. I mean, it's
that's
just
that's
possible.
Also a possibility.
That's really up to you what you do and where you use it.
So Doug has entered the session, I think.
Yeah, I already had it logged on.
Doug, how are you? You're pretty late, but good. You're here.
Yeah.
I heard you had some issues with some messages.
Yes, we are working through some asynchronous signature issues.
Mm-hmm.
That it apparently that comes down to we are calling the alert event and having the PI sheet do a little listening type event. So whenever the broadcast message is being
mm-hmm.
populated, there's a little job out there running that we're using it for creating inspection lots.
Mm-hmm.
So as the program runs and says we should be creating inspection lots, the MDA broadcast message goes out and says, oh, send a message back to the PI sheet. If the PI sheet is open at that time, it has a little listener that says, oh, pop up a screen, tells the operator, hey, time to go create another inspection lot.
Mm-hmm.
We had functionality turned on.
And if you turn that off, then you don't have this problem with your asynchronous signal?
Well, no, that's what they're kind of thinking that they were thinking that may have been the root cause of why the PI sheet wasn't signed, to be completed at the time the first signature was being processed, but they're looking into that. So
I didn't look into your message, but what was exactly the problem there?
We had two issues. The first issue was that assigning the first asynchronous signature was good. They would come back in and sign the second asynchronous signature to close the PI sheet, and it was given a message that said status has changed on PI sheet. We think we've resolved that one. But as resolving that one, we also found that the first asynchronous signature at the close of the PI sheet was not moving the status to a to-be-completed status.
Okay. Uh-huh.
So that's what
they're trying to do. So you cannot complete the PI sheet then, or can you?
Well, what we're having to do is that it doesn't happen on all PI sheets. It doesn't happen every time. It just seems a sporadic problem that the first signature, on occasion, will not move it to a to-be-completed status. I take that back. In 4.6c Enhancement Pack 3, we're never moving the process PI sheet to a to-be-completed status with the signature, so we're having to manually go in and do some of those. So we can actually do both signatures, but the PI sheet never goes to a to-be-completed.
Did I hear that right? You're on 4.6c?
I'm sorry. We're on 6.0.
Oh.
Enhancement Pack 3,
okay.
What did I say?
I was confused
because
you said 4.6c and
EHP. You said, no.
Okay.
So, yeah, we're on ECC 6.0 Enhancement Pack 3, before Stack 14.
Mm-hmm.
So,
Okay.
You would use it on the signature strategy.
So, this should work. I mean, I did use that occasionally, the asynchronous signature, not very often. And could you use that in the middle of a PI sheet with not a problem? But
that was the case yesterday. They said you couldn't use it in the middle, and I said no. We use it in the middle in other areas, so it's truly at the close of the PI sheet we're having some issues. So
do you have the feeling that the message is worked on in a timely manner? Is it okay? Or
that's one thing that they're struggling with it because it doesn't.
Okay, but they give you regular feedback, so it's not
good.
Okay,
right.
Great.
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
Sometimes they struggle, I mean, yeah. But it's up to them. They have to cope with this.
Correct.
Okay. Any more questions?
I have another question, if you don't mind. Weighing integration.
Mm-hmm.
We were discussing weighing integration earlier today, actually, and we were looking at two scenarios. One scenario where you would just enter the field or the scale, also the weighing string, via 232 interface.
Mm-hmm.
So you just push a button and then it will fill it in as if it was a keyboard entry.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and then the second one was that you would send a request to the weighing system, and the weighing system would return that request.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, as I understood it, this is, and it might be that some of you have experience with this, but the thing that we are thinking of is the using a Mettler Toledo weighing PC, which
mm-hmm.
where you would both have the weighing weighing console, and you could also run the PI sheet through a SAP GUI on the same unit.
Mm-hmm.
And
but you are aware of the fact that you could also use OPC directly into the PI sheet.
In the fourth session, I
presented this. Yeah.
Yeah, we asked for that, but mm-hmm. they say that they weren't able to support OPC here. So,
well, they have this OPC bridge, Mettler.
Okay.
It's a small black box which supports this. And actually, I did an implementation in southern Germany with a pharmaceutical customer where we did this, and it's also a reference customer. So,
yeah.
If you need to, if your customer to have a look at it, I can arrange for contact.
Okay.
If you want
reference, this. Okay.
And I also have a success story. I think they're available.
Yeah, Arnie, we are doing the same thing with OPC server. It's integration with PI sheet.
Who is that?
This is Doug.
Oh, Doug.
Yeah, in our Cincinnati plant, we did the same implementation where we used OPC server integration for bringing back GrossNet and Tear with a push of a button.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. Exactly.
Yeah.
So, and with Mettler, this should be done. I'm not sure, Mettler has a global organization, yes, but I'm not sure whether each organization abroad knows about this. Maybe you should ask them, please go back to your colleagues in Germany and ask them, what about this OPC bridge? It's called OPC bridge, so ask them about this, and that should work.
Yes.
Arnie, I would tell you, our local vendor was not as knowledgeable. We had to get him to do a little digging and find that overseas in Europe and Germany, they knew more about it than our guy here in the States.
Yes. That's a little bit an issue there in terms of supportability. Yeah, but technically, they have that device, and they can send it.
Okay. Because they were saying, okay, the thing that they would do, they have some ActiveX that you should try to connect to.
Mm.
So I was thinking now to go to one of the programmers to hear, okay, how can you access that ActiveX?
The details of that solution is as follows. They have this small black box with no moving parts. It has a Linux operation system.
Yeah.
And there they've got the OPC server running and also the client for R3
mm-hmm.
and also a small web server which handles an applet, so a weighing applet for graphical display. And then they have a possibility to attach three weigh scales there, and then they can and you can only use one scale per time. So you have to decide, okay, big, medium, small, and then it switches.
Yeah, sure.
Hmm?
Okay, thanks. It was very, very valuable information.
That's why this is for. Okay. Any other question, comments? If not,
Arnie, one question from here.
Yes.
You explained some of the PADI enhancement options for the X-step generation scope. Is there anything similar in regular PI sheet?
What do you mean by regular PI sheet? I mean, it's process instruction sheet, the old way.
Yeah, in the old way.
No. Plainly.
Okay. We don't have any PADI option.
No. The only thing you can do there is you can use function modules where you can input and output tabular values, and you can use repeated data requests to you fill certain values with the function module. And you can do this either by pushing a button or also by using an event, provided you have a release 4.7 or bigger. And then you can do something like that as well. But no generation on control recipe generation. Flexibility there.
Okay. We are on UCC6, in fact.
Which company is that, actually?
We are from Merck & Co.
Oh, the U.S. Merck.
Yeah, U.S. Merck, correct.
Okay, so today we've got both companies in one session here. Great.
We use the PI sheet quite extensively.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have so far 4 plants went live with SAP. All the 4 plants, they use the PI sheet for entire manufacturing, for both the bulk manufacturing as well as for the packaging.
Mm-hmm.
So within in PI sheet, it's not connected to any external systems or something.
Mm.
But within SAP, we use many functions from PI sheet. So we have all the goods issue table, all the process step validation, all the goods issue and the goods receipt validation, reconciliation.
Did I already ask you how many users are using PI sheets at Merck US?
At the moment, we have gone live only with Mexico and Puerto Rico. It's about 300 users, I would say.
Okay.
So we are planning to go live in US sometime next year beginning.
Okay.
So that time it may get doubled or 700 users we can expect.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
So that's nice to hear also some of about status of our customers' implementations and. Maybe again the suggestion as last session we had a customer presentation here in this Exit Cafe. Whenever you feel that you can maybe also contribute to the community here with an example of your own implementation, you're free and very welcome to tell me, and then you can have your own session here within this Exit Cafe. Presenting this, I would. Yeah, that would be very nice. Okay, so having said this, it's nearly the hour. I would like to close the session. And thank you very much for attending.
Thank you.
And
thank you.
I think most probably, yes, next session will be in September because in August I'm on vacation. So I will send this around as well. But just for you to know. Okay?